Hi, and welcome to Econ 481-3. These lectures were recorded while I was teaching this class over Zoom in the spring 2021. Since Zoom recordings cannot be kept because they show the students' faces and their audio, I decided to simultaneously record only my voice, my screen, and my video to be able to share and distribute these videos later on freely. As a result of this recording method, you may see that sometimes I stay in silence or that I respond to questions that you cannot hear here. And even though I have edited the video so that, you know, this problem doesn't arise too often, it may occasionally happen. In either case, I hope that you enjoy the videos anyway, and I see you next time. Bye now. All right, so well, then let's get started with the first lecture of Econ 481-3. This is going to be on selection of observables, and the two references that are important for what I want to say today, at least if you want to just look at the minimum, are these two that are listed over here. So this first part of the class is just going to be divided in five now that I'm going to talk about outcome tests at some point, but I didn't add that yet. And we're going to go as follows. Today, we're going to talk about selection on observables. I'm going to talk about potential outcomes versus latent variables. I'll talk about causal inference, selection bias, and selection on non-observables, and selection on the propensity score. That's going to be today's class. Second class, we're going to just remove this idea of selection on observables, and we're going to introduce selection of unobservables. And then we're going to talk about ROI models and the local average treatment effect. We're going to talk about the role of heterogeneity, and we're going to talk about late in a lot of different settings, including multiple instruments and covariates and something called Abadie's kappa. The third lecture, we're going to move away from late, and we're going to go over the so-called marginal treatment effect framework of Ekman and Bidlasil. We're going to define what type of parameters can be written as functions of marginal treatment effects, and we're going to talk about the so-called policy-relevant treatment effects. And then the last class of this blog is going to be on extrapolations. And the idea is going to be about what are the parameters that you care about. Can you write these parameters as certain functions of marginal treatment effects or things like that? And what can you obtain from these parameters if you do not impose strong assumptions on these MTs and so on? So it's going to be a partially identified setting, okay? Trying to extrapolate to things like, say, the average treatment effect, which most often are really hard to identify except in simple settings. And, you know, can we extrapolate? Can we take what we know and extrapolate to parameters that we may care about? So that's the idea. So that's why I call this sort of like IB 101. Of course, it's modern IB. We're not going to talk about regression at all, okay? But this is... covers pretty much the main ingredients of this topic. All right. Motivation. Motivation is going to be the so-called counterfactual questions. As you know, this morning I was teaching the usual lecture in Econ 480 about the three interpretations of beta, right? And every year I go and talk about three interpretations of beta. I have a set of students who just don't understand what does it mean for beta to be causal or not. And, you know, over the years, I think about what the problem is. And part of the problem, I was saying this morning, is that the students are not used to think about counterfactual questions. Even though you do it, but you don't think about it, like, objectively, about the fact that you're thinking about counterfactual questions. So here I listed, like, five, right, in different fields. What would happen if a job training program were expanded? Well, the question, the nature of the counterfactual questions, we're asking something that didn't happen, right? Just this hasn't happened. There may be a job training program, but it has a given size, and we don't know what would happen if we just make it larger, okay? What would happen if prices, you know, or welfare, if two firms merge? Well, the idea is that right now, these two firms are not merged, okay? And if they merge, things will change. And if they change, how are they going to change? What would different monetary policies do to real output? Well, the idea is that we're not asking about a policy that maybe you did a year ago or perhaps the situation this year is sufficiently different that the policy that we did a year ago would be different today, but we're asking about something that didn't happen. And this is the idea of counterfactuals, okay? What's the effect of a medication, a vaccine on a disease, on the odds that you get sick, on the odds that you die, okay? What will happen to temperatures if we decrease emissions, okay? Right now we have a certain level of emissions. These are like counterfactual questions. And the difference of counterfactual questions relative to other areas of, say, statistics or, you know, think about machine learning, that they have nothing to say about this. Because if something didn't happen, then you cannot train your model, right? So a machine learner would tell you, use the training data, and then you make a forecast. Well, yes, but if I don't know, I don't have any data on the job training program that was, double the size of the one that we have today, I need to do some form of extrapolation. And then that's what this is about. That doesn't mean that machine learning is not useful for causal inference, because, you know, there are a number of papers today that are making the case, but it's just a tool to solve an in-between step. Most often the actual end step, it has nothing to do with how well you can fit or a model. So thinking about causality, a role here, or counterfactual, sorry, requires you to think about causality. What moves first? What, you know, changes something that comes later? And if you're a theorist or you're somebody that likes models, like because in Econ we like models, that's good. That's typically the starting point. But the problem is that the theory gives us, typically the sign of an effect, okay, the direction, but it will never give us the magnitude, okay? Rarely you write a model which is like, well, the derivative of this to that is 3%, something like that. It depends on things that we don't know. So at most we can say it's positive or it's negative, if we can determine the sign. Sometimes not even the sign is determined. So that is how we talk about counterfactuals here. And the way to think about counterfactuals is using the potential outcome notation. It's not the way, it's one way, okay, that is popular. And the reason why it is popular, it's probably because it's simple, okay? And it forces you to think in this way of exercise of forcing you to think about kind of factual alternative path, okay, that a person, an individual, or whatever agent or unit in your model may take. So these are known as a Neyman, Fisher, Roy, Quandt, Rubin causal model. If you read a paper by any one of Rubin's students, they will say the Rubin causal model. But there's a bunch of people that use similar ideas. So anyway, any of those will work. So we're going to let script D be mutually exclusive, an exhaustive set of states. We're going to call these treatments, okay? Treatment could be binary, like training, not training, a vaccine, not a vaccine, or it could be continuous, like prices, okay? Could be anything. But for each D in this set, we're going to define a potential outcome. And here I'm going to use Y sub D as opposed to parentheses D or whatever, because for this type of objects that we're going to define moving forward, this notation is more convenient, okay? Yd is what would happen if the state were D, okay? Of course, as usual, we're not going to observe Yd for all D. What we observe is the actual state, which is a random variable. You know, again, if we're thinking about the binary case, which is the one that we're going to focus a lot on, is whether people say got a vaccine or not. Well, whether you get a vaccine or not is a random variable, but you got one. You got are either one or zero, right? And then what we're going to observe is the outcome. And the outcome can be written in this way over here, right? Where it's just one of the YDs, and in particular is a YD for the D that you got. It's Y capital D, okay? So Y capital D is observed, but we don't observe the potential outcomes of all the other possible things that could have happened to you. In the case of the vaccine, if you just got the vaccine, you observe Y1, say, one is getting the vaccine, but then you don't observe Y0 for that same individual, okay? We said this a lot of times, and I know I'm sort of like going fast because I know that I set some of these things in 480, but if for whatever reason they are agent history for you, just let me know and I'll review. I'm happy to do that. So what do we want to measure? The part that it is important is that ideally we just want to one, you know, we want to get these YDs, okay? Because the YDs are what we don't know. These are the counterfactuals. These are the main objects because they capture, as I said, the what if aspect of causality. But the problem is that they're random variables. So like, what does it mean getting the YD? Well, you know, the distribution of YD or something like that. Well, most often, as with random variables, people try to find ways to summarize the information in a random variable. And these summaries are typically called the parameter of interest, okay? And so, you know, we're going to talk about some in a minute, but think about this example. Suppose that D indicates participation in a job training program. So 0 is you don't participate, D1 is you participate. And Y is a scalar labor market outcome, such as earnings. Then if D is equal to 1, we observe Y1. Of course, we don't observe Y0 and the other way around. So I wrote here, there are many possible questions one could ask. You say, you know, could say, what would be the average earnings if everybody were trained? Well, that would be the expected value of Y1, okay? And that is possibly a parameter of interest, okay? Think about the setting where Y is hospitalization, okay? And D is where you go to COVID vaccine now. Well, this is what would be the hospitalization rate if everybody were vaccinated? It's a fair question that you can ask, right? And that's it. It's just the expected value of Y1. You could say, what is the average effect of the program? Okay, this is what we call the average treatment effect, okay? Which is the hospitalization rate if you get vaccinated versus not getting vaccinated. Or in this case, you know, it would be your earnings with the training or without the training. And we see, you know, how effective this is in, and on the outcome. And you can ask, what about only those that are trained? Okay, so in principle, you may be completely, it may be of total interest to just know what's happening to people that are trained or to people that are vaccinated, because you may have questions that only affect that particular subpopulation. Okay, so you think about, okay, that's what I care about. So none of these three parameters that are listed here are more relevant than any other, even though you may say, well, the average treatment effect is the one that is the most popular. It is popular, but not because it is most interesting. Sometimes people just follow conventions, okay? Things become a convention, and so everybody uses that. But the most important thing is to think, for the context of an application, what is the actual parameter that captures the main question that you have in mind, okay? And most often, these parameters can be written as function of this Y1 and Y0. So that's the potential outcome notation. There's something called latent variable notation, okay? What is it? Well, typically, I would say in empirical economics or models, you write parameters that look like this. Y is a function of D, which is the treatment, and other stuff. And you include the other stuff in this U. And U is an unobservable variable. Okay? And so a causal interpretation of this model says this. YD would be G of D U. So you can move D exogenously, and then you get a different Y. The model of how to generate Y. This actual notation, it's often used, for example, when you're doing simulations. You need to generate the potential outcome. So this is a normal way of generating potential outcome. You know what's the process that creates Y. This is aligned with what we do in regression. Right? Go back to 480s. Like, you can write, oh, beta D plus U. This approach of the latent variable is what we normally use when we use regressions. Okay, implicitly, when we interpret beta causally and all this, we're assuming that we have something like this. Okay, now the thing is that these two approaches of defining or describing a counterfactual are equivalent. Okay, it's just, as I wrote here, just notation. Okay, you can just translate from one or the other one. But I wrote at the top, some people are really dogmatic about this. Okay, and then some researchers, since this is being recorded, I'm gonna be careful. I've fought over years about, like, oh, my notation is better than your notation because it captures this, it doesn't capture that. And then, you know, there may be merits to one over the other one, but at the end of the day, it's notation. And I'll say the potential outcomes are more broadly used in fields like labor, okay, public finance, more like reduced form type of fields, okay? And this latent variable notation is typically more useful in fields that are more structural, like I/O, okay? Because you write down models and you have equations for demand and preferences and all this, so it makes more sense to just describe what gives agents utility, what are the profits of the firm, or so on. And you describe that as a function of things that you observe and things that you do not observe, okay? So other than this, they're capturing the same goal, which is trying to model a counterfactual. Questions? All right. So hopefully that made the distinction between potential outcomes and latent variables clear. We're going to talk about random assignment and the so-called fundamental problem of causal inference. So we're going to assume random assignment for now. Okay. Why? This is simpler. And then the advantage of this is that if you show that there are certain things that cannot be identified in these settings, well, most likely they're not going to be identified in other settings either, because this is sort of like make things really clean. The random assignment assumption is going to be that this vector of potential outcomes, all potential outcomes, are independent of the treatment. Okay. So imagine going back to the job training example or the COVID vaccine example, if somebody gets or not the treatment or the vaccine by just flipping a coin, okay, then it doesn't matter what your potential outcomes are. You're just getting a D that is endogenous. The thing then is that under random assignment, you can identify the distribution of YD for all D. And how do you do that? Well, the CDF of YD, okay, which is, say, the object that we want, is the probability that YD is less than or equal to a number, letter Y. Then by the random assignment or independence, this is the same as the conditional distribution of YD given D, okay, because they're independent. And now guess what? When D is equal, the capital D is equal to little d, the YD is just the observed Y. And so this is the probability of the observed Y less than or equal to a number, condition on D equal to little d. This is observed. This is what we want. And so this is identified. How do I identify distribution? Just condition on everybody that got the vaccine, and you say stuff. Condition on everybody that did not get the vaccine, and you say stuff. And that's how you do it, okay? The intuition is that condition on treatment does not affect, does not change potential outcomes. People are not choosing whether to get, say, vaccinated or not, depending on their outcomes, okay? People are not choosing to go to the job training program because they feel that, you know, their incomes are going to suck if they don't just go to the job training program, and so on. In this case, in which you have random assignment, there's no choice. You just get what you get. We're going to talk about selection and all this stuff later. So what are parameters that you can compute then? Well, you can compute any parameter that is a function of these marginal CDFs. For example, the average treatment effect, which is the expected value of Y1 and expected value of Y0. That's a function of F1, function of F0. The average treatment effect on the treated, which is expected value of Y1 minus Y0 conditional on D equal to 1. The quantile treatment effect, which is the quantile of Y1 minus the quantile of Y0 for any quantile that you pick. The quantile of the treated or the untreated, okay, which you can define analogously by conditioning on D equals to 1 or D equal to 1. They're all point identified under random assignment, okay? And in particular, under random assignment, they're all the same regardless of whether you condition on D or not. Because, of course, D is independent of Y. So the expected value of Y conditional on D has to be the same as the one unconditional one. So the average treatment effect is the same as the average treatment on the treated and the average treatment effect on the untreated. Okay. If D is multivalued or continuous, we're going to talk later, conventions are less established. If it's multivalued, suppose that D takes five values, well, then nothing conceptually changes. Just the notation becomes annoying. But then typically people will make pairwise comparisons, okay? Treatment 4 against treatment 3, or treatment 3 against treatment 2, or some treatment versus non-treatment, and so on, okay? But if D is continuous, then things change. And we're going to briefly discuss this later, but then things become more complicated. So the multivalue is not conceptually different. It's just notationally more complicated. The continuous one is conceptually different. What is the so-called fundamental problem of causal inference? Fundamental problem of causal inference is that even with random assignment, the joint distribution of the potential outcomes are not identified. Why? Because you never observe both Y1 and Y0 at the same time. So even something really simple as the correlation between Y1 and Y0 cannot be identified even in the context where you have random assignment. And this already implies that, you know, we have a problem to start with. Every single parameter that we care about must be a function of the marginals and cannot be a function of the joint distribution, right? So most features of Y1 minus Y0 are all here, okay, which is the treatment effect of an individual, are not point identified. The expected value is, because it's a linear operator. And so when you pass the expectation, it becomes just the expectation of Y1 minus the expectation of Y0, which are functions of the marginals. But other stuff are more difficult. And the important thing is that if this is the case with random assignment, it's going to be the case without random assignment. As we move forward, we try to capture other things like selection, okay, and other stuff. Well, like if you cannot do or identify the object in this ideal world, you won't be able to do it as you make your model more flexible. For example, think about this. You care about the proportion of individuals who are hurt, okay, which is this over here. Well, that is not point identified. Or what's the fraction of individuals that are going to be worse off by getting the treatment relative to not getting the treatment? You cannot, because this depends on the joint distribution, okay? And again, I wrote not point identified because there are results that, you know, you may use to just partially identify some of these objects under some assumptions, okay? But in principle, you need to imagine that you need to make assumptions because, as I said, you're never going to be able to observe both for each individual. Nor are the quantiles of Y1 minus Y0. And that's the difference of the quantile treatment effect, which I wrote before, versus the quantile of the treatment effect. The quantile of the treatment effect, we cannot say anything about because it's just about, you know, this difference of a random variable, Y1 minus Y0. Whereas the quantile of the treatment effect, which is the object that I had over here, is just the function of two marginals separately. Marginal of Y1, marginal of Y0, okay? And that is the so-called fundamental problem of causal inference. Now, people typically add covariates, okay? Covariates are there everywhere and they play a role. And there's a huge literature on this. I'm thinking that I may include some of this in a problem set, but we'll see later. I was thinking this the other day I was preparing this class. But suppose that we regress Y on D and some predetermined random variables X, okay? Other covariates that you see. So D is randomly assigned. So they should be uncorrelated with X because X were determined before you assigned the treatment. So typically people will check for balance. They will just look at means or things to see that these variables don't seem to depend on D, but that's irrelevant, okay? What happens is that if we now include these X's, okay, in our analysis, you can show that the coefficient on D will go down, okay? And that's, as I said, there are so many papers, even new papers in the last years that show how these mechanics work in different settings, but the simplest setting is the one in which D is independent, because in that case, there are no questions asked. This is true. You add more stuff, and then the variation on the coefficient on D, or that you try to estimate, goes down by construction. How much it goes down depends on how much X and Y are correlated. I mean, it's not about tossing unrelated things to your, say, analysis or regression. It's about using things that matter. So here I wrote a silly example, but it's obvious. Sometimes I like to use very obvious examples because it's what probably makes it stick in your head. But if Y is the cholesterol level after the experiment, D is a drug to intended to reduce cholesterol, okay? You're taking some drug to do that. And then X is the cholesterol in the past before you join the experiment, okay? well, of course, the cholesterol today is going to be related to the cholesterol yesterday, right? So I wrote here, X probably explains a lot of the variation in Y. And so by including X, okay, you're going to reduce the variation in Y, but not in D because D is independent of Y. And so this will allow you to estimate D more precisely. Okay. So that's the role of covariates. Okay. So we're going to talk about covariates as we move forward. So that was just sort of like a first initial thing. We're going to get back to it. So what's the scope of random assignment? When is random assignment a good assumption? I said, well, now we know that in fields like experiment, like in development, we actually do have actual experiments, okay? So in those settings, people don't have any control over D, okay? So you say, well, I have an experiment. You're a development economist. Of course, you can work under these results that are derived under random assignment. What is also common and less convincing is when you have a model that you have survey data or some data that doesn't come from an experiment, and you say D here was exogenous, even though agents could have chosen D, but I think it's just like a coin flip, okay? Well, that happens. I'm going to show you some examples later, but I'm not saying it is impossible, but it's harder to justify. That's what I wrote, less likely, okay? So in practice, in economics, even today, the leading case for something like this are the randomized control experiments that are mostly in development, but they're in other areas as well. And in other settings, when agents can control D, we're going to have selection. Okay, when I talk about it, but it's expected you're going to have selection. So, the final few things that I wrote here is that random assignment leads to high internal validity, but typically they have lower external validity, okay? Because you take a sample to do an experiment and everything that you learn is for the setting in which your sample applies, and it's harder to just take whatever lessons you learned there to the entire population. Possible, but still, this is sort of, I'll say, the main feature of the randomized control experiment. They're typically called a gold standard. Okay, in biostatistics and other fields and economics sometimes as well. And something that is important that we're not going to talk this quarter because I'm not going to cover this topic is that, you know, even when you have experiments these days, it's very rare that you're just going to flip a coin. Okay, here, everything I said when people talk about an experiment is like D is independent of X is, but in practice, the way people assign units to treatment and control tend to be sophisticated. There are things that are called covariate adaptive randomization, where people just first stratify on certain values of the covariates, and then within strata, they assign 50% to treatment, 50% to control, things like that. Or there are even areas where you use something called response adaptive randomization, and you assign people to treatment and control depending on how units start to respond to the treatment as you move forward, okay? And so these things are not about flipping a coin. And all this affect a lot of the analysis, typically not the identification, but certainly the inference, okay? So how you do test a confidence in so on. All right. So selection. The selection into the treatment state D, if the conditional distribution of YD given D is distributed differently from YD given D prime, okay? And again, you would expect this to occur if agents choose D with knowledge of their potential outcomes, okay? So look, think about this example. So agent choose whether to join the job training program, okay? And they want to maximize their utility. The utility, of course, incorporates your future earnings, okay, which are given by Y1, your earnings if you join the program, and Y0, your earnings if you don't join the program. Let's assume that this is a sample of people that are unemployed, okay? Well, agents who choose the job training might do so because of low Y0, meaning you know that your salary or your earnings moving forward are low, you need more skills, and if you acquire more skills, you can increase your earnings, okay? That's a good reason to join the program. Okay. But in reality, some people may just choose D0 because they have a high expected Y0. For example, your dad is rich, okay? You don't need to work. So yeah, your skills are really low. You would be unable to find a job anywhere. But your dad is rich. So you have a high Y0. You don't join the job training program. And the problem is that is if now we just collect data of these individuals, okay? Then what we find is that the objects that we typically use end up being biased for what we intend them to capture, okay? So I wrote here, consider the simple setting where you have binary treatment, okay? Treatment control, and then we care about the average treatment effect, okay? So what we do is you compute the expectation of Y given treated minus the expectation of Y conditional being untreated. And so let me just say that when D equals 1, Y is equal to Y1. When D equals 0, Y is equal to Y0. And let me add and subtract the expected value of Y0 conditional on D equals 1. This is what I've done here. Just added and subtracted this object. So now we split it and look at this first part. This is the average treatment on the treated. It's the expected value of Y1 minus Y0 conditional on D equals to 1. And this term over here is called selection bias. If D is independent of Y0, of course, this is equal to 0 because this is expected value of Y0 minus expected value of Y0. But here, if they are not dependent, what may happen is the following. Suppose that this is a job training program and these are earnings, okay? Then the average treatment on the treated may be positive. Your earnings go up if you join the program and then you do it and you acquire new skills, okay? But what if outside this, you have a lot of people that have rich dads, okay? So this is really high. This is over here is low, okay? Well, then this selection bias is going to be negative, okay? What you obtain at the end of the day is that you have something positive with something negative. You compute the average treatment or the difference of the average between the treated and untreated, and this is roughly 0. You conclude that the program doesn't have any effect on earnings, okay? When in reality, the program was highly successful, the problem is that in your sample, you had a lot of people that chose to do D0 just because they had high earnings, okay? The same thing applies if you want to think about, again, a vaccine, COVID, or whatever. A lot of people that are young and healthy decide not to get vaccinated, okay? The people that are sick are the ones, and weak are the ones that decide to get vaccinated. Selection bias is huge, okay? And they don't need to know exactly, as Philippe said, like what's the actual value of why. They just need to know that they're young and healthy, and that's it. And, you know, on average, this is going to be high, okay? Because this is young and healthy people. This is old and weak people. And so it turns out that this is the selection term, okay? And so this may often mitigate the effect of the treatment, like this example over here. And you can cook up examples in which actually you find that the effects are huge, when in reality, the effects are really small, and you can just do it in any direction. There are settings in which you can tell a story that makes sense that may go in either case. But the reality is then we have this selection bias term that shows up the minute that there is that units or agents can choose D. So what do you do in that case? Well, the first simple solution and the title of today's lecture is selection on observables. So what people say is like, well, yeah, I know that D is not truly randomized, but what I'm going to assume is that D is randomized or independent of the potential outcomes, conditional on X's, conditional on observables. Sometimes these are called controls, okay? And so the idea then is that conditional on X treatment is as good as randomly assigned. It's not true if I remove the conditioning on X. But once you condition on X, that happens. This is called selection on observables, unconfoundness, ignorable treatment assignment, and maybe even some other names. Okay? And as I wrote here, it underlies the causal interpretation of linear. Okay. Because in principle, people will run regression of the outcome on the variable that you care about and then add a lot of stuff to the right. And the more stuff you write, you add to the right, the more you believe that this assumption holds. Okay. And that's how it goes. What is the identification argument? It's exactly the one that we did before, except that now you just add x's everywhere. But just start with the conditional distribution of y given x, yd, sorry. And so this is the probability of yd less than a number, condition x being equal to little x. This is the probability of yd equal to a number. And you can add d now because, you know, condition on x, d and y are independent. And so now, given that d is equal to little d, yd is the observed y. And then you have an object that you observe, okay? Now, it is important to notice that, you know, the trick is that in the second equality, we assume overlap, which is a condition that we're going to need, which is condition on x, you need to observe people in each of the treatments that you have, okay? This, depending on the context, may or may not be an issue. We're going to discuss it. But then you just integrate over x, so you just take the expectation of this with respect to x, and then you just get the marginal distribution of y. So now we identify the marginal distribution of y and the conditional distribution of y given x. So we can identify any parameters that are functions of the marginal of the potential outcomes or the conditional marginals of the potential outcomes. Okay. And the arguments are, again, the same. So what are these parameters? Well, again, let's focus on the case again that D is binary. Okay. We show that the average treatment effect now can be identified as the conditional, as the expectation of the conditional average treatment effect. By conditional, I mean conditional on X. And so again, now this guy over here can be replaced by the observed Y because we add the D since D is independent of Y conditional on X. And these are quantities that we can get from the data. It just requires us to get the conditional expectation of Y given D0 and X and the conditional expectation of Y given D1 and X, and then take an average of that. How do we get these conditional expectations? Up to us. We can do it non-parametrically using, say, Naira Watson type of estimators. We can assume that this conditional expectation is linear in the X's and whatever, and then you do regression. This is an area where we can now and say, look, we're going to use some fancy machine learning thing that will give us the conditional expectation of Y given X, and you can do that, okay? And then later on, you just average over the X's, and then you get an estimator of the average treatment effect. Then if you look at other quantities like the average treatment on the treated, it has some differences, the same for the untreated, because the average treatment on the treated identifies the first object just by the expected value of Y given D1, okay? And then that's simple because here we don't have a conditional expectation as a function of X. This is just a number that is really easy to estimate. And whereas the part that is the counterfactual part, which is the Y0, the one that we don't observe, is the one that we estimate using D1, the model, okay? Anyway, so notice that, as I wrote here, for a lot of the math and the parameters that we typically care about, mean independence is enough, okay? So you need something like this. This is all we need. We need that this conditional expectation of the potential outcomes, conditional on Y, on D0 and D1 are the same. But nobody writes this typically, okay? Because it's hard to think about only conditional expectations in this setting. So the usual assumption is about independence. So you're going to see this all the time. You're rarely, if ever, going to see an assumption like this, okay? Which is certainly weaker. But, you know, the way that things work in this particular literature on counterfactuals, you know, makes it like hard to tell stories about this, and it's easy to tell stories about independence. Now, something I want to mention in one slide, and it may be in the homework because people ask questions. Yes. Yeah, this is a typo here. So this should be like this. Write it well. there. Is expect the value of y given d equal to 0 and x, okay? And then you need to average. This is a function of x over those individuals that have d equal to 1. Right? Sure. Controlling them too much. This is sort of like to demystify some of the folklore that sometimes people use that just is wrong. And so suppose that you have selection on observables and that y1 and y0 independent on the condition on x. And now suppose that x2 is a subset of x. And the x1 is a subset of x2, okay? So you have that x1 is a subset of x2, which is a subset of x, okay? The assumption of selection and observables is if you control or condition on x. So if we manage to observe x, then we'll be fine. We'll just do things that we said, everything goes through, okay? But let's suppose that x is a lot of stuff and we don't observe x, but we observe x2, okay? That means we also observe x1. So controlling on x, I wrote here, is the most information, and x1 is the least information, but we don't observe x, okay? So, and what I wrote here is that using x2 can introduce more bias than using x. This is the part that is important. Adding information need not reduce bias. It does if you get to the actual full conditioning set, okay? It does, of course, if you assume something like y1, y0 condition independent of d condition on x2, okay? That works, of course. But the assumption is that it's conditional on x. You need to condition on all x, but we don't observe all the x's, okay? So we just observe some x's. And so now that you observe some x's, intuitively you say, well, the more I use, the better, okay? That is not true. This created confusion in the past. The reason why I don't prove it in one slide, because the proof in the example is just a lot longer than one slide. But I'm going to add it, if I can, to the problem set, okay? In as simple way as possible. But this is a point I wrote here that is not well appreciated. I talk to people, I see that they didn't even think about this, okay? And it's concerning as how this is typically used, okay? And that the more you add, the better, something like that. But anyway, should be if you're looking at the screen saying this is confusing, it should be confusing, okay? But hopefully you'll have time to think more about it. We're going to move to the role of the propensity score. Do you have questions up until now? So I talk about this in 480, so I'm assuming you know, you may have forgotten, but let's stick to the binary treatment, d equals 0 and 1. And then the propensity score is the probability that d equals 1 condition on x. Okay, that's the propensity score. It's a random variable, so we can call it capital P as a random variable, or a function P of capital X, which are the covariates, okay? And so this paper that we went over this argument in 480 shows essentially that conditioning on X, in the case where you have selection on observables, is the same as conditioning on P, okay? And this was an important insight. The argument was simple. You start with the probability of d equal 1 condition on the potential outcomes and p, okay? And so you then condition on x as well, okay, by the law of iterated expectations. And then once you condition on x, having p here is redundant because p is a function of x, so p is gone. And then once you look at this object over here, since you have selection on observables, we said selection on observables means that D is independent of the potential outcomes condition on X, so the potential outcomes are gone. And now you have, this is P, and the expected value of P conditional on P is P. Okay? So in other words, you know, you show here that conditional on P, this guy is independent of the potential outcome. And so the condition, the implication is that we can condition on P instead of X. Why do you care about that? Well, again, X could be dimension K, okay? It could be 10 random variables you have, 20, 100, 1,000. P is a scalar. And not only is it scalar, it's a scalar with a very simple interpretation of the propensity score, which is the probability that somebody will get into treatment, okay, conditional on their X's. So it's a scalar that goes, is in between 0 and 1, has a very easy interpretation. So that, you know, now simplifies things a lot. So that's the first part, which is conceptual. The second benefit is that you can now write the parameters that we care about. Instead of like condition on the X's and so on, now you can just use this propensity score. For example, you can write the average treatment effect as an average, weighted average of the Y's, okay? And in particular, the conditional on X average treatment effect can be written as expected value of Y times D minus the propensity score times 1 minus the propensity score condition on X. And if you take an average over X, then you have this expression over here for the average treatment effect. And so it's different than the one that we used before, and it requires knowledge of the propensity score. Later on, it will require us to be able, say, to estimate the propensity score. Once, if you have the propensity score, then you can use these formulas to identify the parameters that you care about. And you typically have one for average treatment effect or average treated on the treated, okay? And the derivations are in the problem set, as I said earlier. Again, this morning, you know, I was teaching, as I said, 480. You are, you know, old 480 students, right? You're mature now. And so, you know, when I talk about causality and the effect of causal effects and so on and versus prediction, and I said this morning when you want to predict something, sometimes you don't care about causality. It's true that in economics, we care about causality, but that doesn't mean that we care about causality everywhere, okay? And here's an example in which typically we don't care about causality, which is the propensity score. If we just look at the propensity score, is the probability that D equals 1 conditional on X, okay? This is a prediction problem. Give me the x's and tell me what are the odds that D is equal to 1, okay? Typically, we don't care about what's the effect on this propensity score of a particular x, okay? Oh, how would the propensity score change if I move this x or whatever? That would be a causal question, right? Well, typically, I'm not saying there may be settings where you care about that, but I'm saying typically, you don't care about that. You just want the propensity score because once you put the propensity score in here, you can estimate the objects that you want. So this, as an intermediate step of getting a causal object, which is the average treatment effect, you are doing a prediction exercise, which is getting the propensity score. And again, how to do prediction? Yeah, you can do a logit, a probit, a kernel method. You could do random forest. You can do machine learning. You can do whatever you want. It's just, you know, what are the tools that will give you a good prediction? And at this stage, you don't care about, you know, causal effects or marginal effects or anything, typically. So that is to say, there is room for every single type of analysis. It depends on the end goal, okay? And sometimes, you know, you care about things, sometimes you don't. So the summary is that we have three different constructive identification results for the average treatment effect. You match on X, you match on P, or use weights using P. And it showed that the ATE, for example, is point identified. They're all derived using the same assumptions, okay? They just lead to different expressions, okay? And the different expressions typically lead to different estimators, okay, that may have different properties, okay? So the literature will discuss some of these estimators have sometimes different optimality rates that require, if they are non-parametric, different rate of convergences, they adapt differently, they have different bias properties, and so at the end of the day, it's asymptotic properties. Most importantly, there are differences in finite samples, and as far as I know, which again, I'm not an expert in this literature, there are a lot more modern things than the ones that I'm illustrating here, not that you have something that dominates author. Weighting has problems, as matching has problems. And, you know, there's a literature now on doubly robust estimators. Have you ever heard about doubly robust estimators? So, all right, multivalued treatments. Long slide. I always regret having this line. But anyway, so this is to say the following. Binary treatment is the model case in the literature by far. You take any theory paper, it's just going to be binary treatment. You ask me why? Well, because D1, D0 is easy, okay? So, and it's actually popular. And then if you tell me, well, what if I had three treatments, okay? Well, there's no payoff to write a paper about 0, 1, 2 because, you know, it requires more notation and people understand that if you solve the 0, 1 case, you can do the 0, 1, 2 case, okay? And so, and the paper is easier to read. So you're going to see a gazillion papers about the binary case and essentially very few papers about the multi-value case just because of notation. Nothing happens. You can extend everything we're learning to the multi-value case. And so I'm not going to talk too much about the multi-value case. The one case that it is different is the continuous case. Okay. And the continuous case, we're not going to cover much. In labor and this public finance fields, D is often binary or discrete. So all that we're going to say applies. The one field in which D continues really matters. IO, prices, which is the usual treatment, okay, there is continuously distributed. And so then the approach there tends to be more structural. You have a model, say how firms compete, what they maximize, what consumers maximize, and you have first order conditions, and then there's equilibrium, blah, blah, blah. And the model gives you counterfactuals later because you change something in your model and you obtain a counterfactual because you're describing everything that has happened in this market. Okay, it's a different way of thinking about counterfactuals. So the literature in labor and public finance and this part of the econometrics literature focuses on things that are discrete. Whoops. Okay, but at the end of the day, you know, since doing 0, 1, 2 is the same, it just adds more notation, most often doesn't add any complication aside from notation, then people just stick to the 0. And I actually, sometimes when I read papers and they go for the multi-value treatment, D and whatever, and the notation is just so overwhelming sometimes that I wish they had written the paper for the binary case. Because most often the main intuition, the main lesson you can get from the binary case, even if you have multiple treatments, you just have to go and adapt things in a straightforward manner. But anyway, I wrote a paper with multiple treatments. There's multiple treatments in the title. But that was different. All right. Final remarks. Are there any questions about that? Criticisms. Okay. Selection and observables can be difficult to believe in economics. If you just think about it, okay, the usual unobservables are preferences, private information, expectations, okay? All these things that anybody who asks you, like, do people take into account their expectations about X and Y when they make their decisions, you're going to say, yes. But you don't observe that in your data. So like, no. So, and then you swallow, okay? But that doesn't mean that this is crazy selection on observables. But in economics in particular, it's just sort of like there are a few settings where you would be able to defend this with a straight face. Most often people will say like, well, there's nothing else that I can do, so I have to live with it. Okay, well, that's a different. So controlling for more is not a solution. This is what we talked about before. People don't believe you that you're missing preferences, prior information, expectations. Now you add more access. Oh, yeah, but I got more access now. I got a second data set, has a lot of access. I want to add more. Well, we just saw that that doesn't help, okay? Or may not help, or doesn't necessarily help. So, plus, you start adding more stuff because now we have big data, okay? Wow, I got 2,352 covariates that I'm going to add to my analysis. Great. But the problem is that you need this overlap condition, right? You need to have people treated and then treated in one of these conditions, these single values of X's. Can you guarantee that? It's often not. It's just going to be 0, 1. You're going to find groups that are zeros or ones and so on. That's a problem. So at the end of the day, it's like, okay, why should I do... and then the last thing, sorry, is that better methods for choosing observables will not solve this. You know, I've seen people say now like, I have 2,000 covariates, but I'm going to use a lasso. So I'm just, you know, I want to just pick up the ones that are important. Oh, yeah, that has it's unrelated to the problem that we wrote in the previous slide. It's just whether you're conditioning the right thing so that you have exogenous Z. Do you have exogenous Z or not? The lasso that has says nothing about it. Okay. So machine learning in particular doesn't help with identification in general. Okay. So two different things. I wrote here, fancier methods. Okay. But the identification assumptions are still the same. So whereas this literature, say machine learning in general, like it's always or most of the time about bias variance trade-off, especially if the literature is not in econometrics. Okay, so people, econometricians now using more machine learning things are trying to bring back notions of identification and things like this. But if you just go to machine learning, it's always bias variance trade-offs. Okay, and bias variance trade-offs are absolutely unrelated to whether Y1, Y0 is independent of the condition on X, not a bias variance argument, okay? So then once you're here, you say, okay, what's next then? Well, it would be to simply acknowledge that you have selections on unobservables. The people are choosing D based on their preferences, based on their private information, based on their expectations, and that you're not gonna be able to observe control for those. So you do that, well, yes, as long as we have something like an instrument, right? Which is what we're gonna see in class. So to conclude today, you know, there's this 98 paper by Angris, okay? And I wrote here misfit selection and observables. And the idea is this is a well-known paper, an application on selection on observables. Why is labor market outcome, it could be earnings, okay, to make it simple, or employment if you want to make it simpler. And D is the veteran status, okay, whether you participate in the military or not. And then X are socioeconomic variables. They have race, year, schooling, age, and so on. And the assumption of that paper is that given X, military participation, okay, is as good as randomly assigned. So which means that observationally similar people, say same age and same race and so on, they just randomly decide to join the military, okay? And, you know, question is, think about it. If you just go today and you present this in an audience, okay, where really people, you think people are gonna believe this argument or not, okay? Things change over time. Perhaps, you know, this paper is already 25 years old, 22, whatever. And so standards change over time as people accept or tolerate certain things at some point than in other times. But I would claim that this paper ignores first order issues, okay, that have to do with employment that also affect whether people decide to join the military or not, and that these issues are unobservable. And so I would say it's hard to believe here that this choice of joining the military is random, okay, conditional on your race, years of education, years and so that's what we're gonna do next time. It's like, okay, if we don't believe this in some, at least some of the applications we care about, can we deal with selection on unobservables? And the answer is gonna be yes, we're gonna deal with that. Of course, we're going to need something else, like an instrument, okay? But once we have something like that, it'll work, and we'll be able to deal with cases like this. We're going to pay a price. With everything, you end up paying a price. The price that we're going to pay is that some of the parameters that we may care about, we won't be able to get else, right? So it's like Joel Horowitz, always says, like, if you cannot get the parameter you want, you just want the parameter you can get. And sort of like something like that. But that's the idea, and that's what we're going to do next class. We're done for today. Questions? All right. Bye now.